o'clock. I can get you in your right. No?
Maybe.
Well, they don't want to hear.
How about now?
Yes, he does. Cool, all right. So now that everybody has a new design buddy, we're going to start the meetup. The first talk is made by Chris. Chris is going to talk about Pokeyok, which is a Japanese design philosophy of error proofing.
Yeah, I've only ever read it, I've never heard it, so I'm assuming that's how it's pronounced. I'm really sorry.
Cool, so don't quote on us for the name itself, for the pronunciation. But without further ado, please welcome stage, Chris.
Yeah, cool. Okay, so yeah, tonight I'd like to talk to you about a bit of a weird obsession that I've developed for a certain design principle, that one. Yeah, you're about to hear a lot about really good plug socket and door design. So, you know, strap in. But don't worry, there's a much more exciting talk and pizza or something coming up. So,
we got that door.
Yeah, there you go. So, totally, right. So, who is this schlub you see standing before you? So, my name is Chris. I'm a UX designer. I have been for about 8 years or so. And over that time, I've worked with a lot of different clients, including those exciting logos up there. But more recently, I'm working on my own UX consultancy called Just UX Design. And even more recently, a little project of mine called ListMaker, which is kind of a website for making top 10 lists and stuff like that. It's kind of a half startup, half weird experiment. So check that out when you get a chance, because it is the hot shizzle. But you're not here to listen to shameless self-promotion. No, you're here to learn about Pokeyok, probably. So contrary to the name and the confusing use of the Pokemon font that I've decided to go for in these slides, this actually has nothing to do with Pokemon. It's a design idea that's actually already really famous in the manufacturing industry. But like Pokemon, it originated in Japan, specifically on Toyota's production lines. What does it mean? Well, quite literally translated, poker means error, and yoke means proof. Put them together, error proof. So it's the idea that you plan a design or an interaction around the idea that the user literally cannot fail. They cannot get it wrong. It's by design impossible for the user to make an error. And because there's no possibility of making an error, they can use the product or service without fear. Just as a bit of background, the original name for Pokeyok was Bakeyok, which translates to idiot proof. But it was renamed to Pokeyok, I guess, on reflection that, you know, it's a bit ironic that you call a user-centered design principle idiot proof, you know, calling users idiots. Probably isn't the best, so Pokeyok. Hooray. That is the last Pokemon reference in these slides, so apologies. So let me introduce you to this handsome devil. So his name is Shigeo Shingo, and he is the creator of Pokeyok. Now, this chap was the head of production for Toyota in the 1960s, and really clever guy, came up with quite a lot of interesting design ideas, including this one. And because he was head of production at Toyota, he spent a lot of time on Toyota's production lines. Now, back in the 1960s, a lot of Toyota's production work was done by hand on kind of a conveyor belt. And this is where Pokeyok started. It started when Toyota were assembling a specific kind of switch. Now, I'm not an engineer, and if there are engineers here, I'm really sorry, because this explanation is going to be absolutely horrendous. So put your fingers in your ears. So essentially, in layman's terms, a spring needed to be inserted into a casing, and then a button needed to go on top. So when you push it, the spring puts the button back into place. Pretty simple. So I'm oversimplifying it massively with this very technical diagram. But you've got a button and a spring. You put the spring inside, and then you've got a completed switch. Fantastic. And this is how these were assembled on this production line. However, there's a problem. It was technically possible for this switch to be assembled defectively, and that was because the production line workers could forget to insert the spring. Oh no. This is a human error, and it's a totally understandable human error, but it's one that cost Toyota thousands of pounds or millions of yen. My 1960s Japanese currency conversion is not the best, I apologize. But it would result in a defective product being put together, and this was really bad for Toyota, because if you're shipping something like a car, and you ship a defective car, that's going to be really expensive. But, think about it. If you're a factory worker and you're having to assemble thousands of these switches every day, chances are that two or three of them, you are going to forget to put that switch inside. That spring inside, rather. Now, Toyota were aware of this issue, and their solution was to blame the user. They're aware of the problem, but they dealt with it by penalizing the factory staff, by just punishing them, beating them within an inch of their lives. I'm pretty sure they didn't actually do that, but they would punish the staff for forgetting to put the spring in, and that was really bad. And this is where our hero of the story breaks onto the scene, because he saw this happening, and he thought, hang on a second, perhaps human error is actually inevitable. And maybe, instead of punishing the user, we should redesign the process and the components to make that error literally impossible. And this is how Pokio was born. So again, oversimplifying it massively, which I apologize, but he redesigned the process so that in order for this switch to come together, the spring needs to be inserted into a placeholder first, and then that placeholder can be combined with the other part. So it was a two-step process where first, the spring goes into the placeholder, and then the product can be assembled. There's literally no way that this can go wrong, because you cannot physically complete the process without going through both steps. And this is where Pokio originates, making it completely error-proof. And this was an idea that became really popular with manufacturing. So other assembly lines followed suit. I'm pretty sure no one's used one of these in about 20 years. This goes to show how down with the kids I am. But say you've got your Walkman and they're being assembled on a factory production line. It would be really easy for a sleepy factory line worker to put the wrong button into the wrong slot. But because the components have been poke-oaked, that's a verb, it is impossible to put the wrong button into the wrong slot because they have these shaped pegs. And, this seems like common sense, but in the 1960s, this was actually a really revolutionary idea. The idea of user error had always been perfectly acceptable, but now we've got this this new rule that says, actually, if your product or your process is capable of user errors, perhaps it's been designed badly. And, sure enough, this became a philosophy that product designers all around the world took on. Every day, you interact with loads of Pokio devices without even thinking about it. And that's exactly the point, because if a device has been designed with a Pokio mindset, you cannot get it wrong, therefore you don't need to think about it. So I wanted to prove this point, so I spent a bit of time this weekend flapping around like an idiot in my flat trying to find Pokio devices. And it didn't take very long. So, here it is, the moment you've all been waiting for, the plug socket. It's a bit dirty, sorry about that. So I think the plug socket, or at least the UK plug socket, is a really good example of a Pokio design. Because of the three-pronged nature of a plug, there is no way that I can put it in any other way than intended. So if I try and put it in sideways, it won't work. There's no way I can get it wrong. So even an idiot can do it. There's no way that we can fail at this task. It's fantastic. There are other great examples in the world of plug socket design too. So if you think about USB, they've got those little plastic grooves on them. And that's there so that you can't put the USB into the USB port upside down. They both marry up, so it can only go in one way. There's only one way for it to go in. Bob's your uncle. Anyone can do it. Simples. Let's talk about microwaves. So microwaves, when you actually think about it, are quite dangerous devices. All of that radiation that's flying around inside that box that's heating up your hot bottle or whatever, that's really dangerous if it's not being contained within the box. So if a fool comes along and tries to yank the door of the microwave open whilst it's switched on, it would be really bad if all the radiation was released. But the product designers thought about that, so that if you do try and yank the door open whilst it's switched on, the microwave shuts itself off, so I cannot commit that error. Same sort of thing with sinks too. So we're probably all familiar with that lovely little hole thing in the top of the sink. As we all know, that is there because if I leave the faucet of my sink running, it's going to fill up with water. Now, you know, I was a bit silly to do that, but luckily, because of that hole, the water drains out and this idiot doesn't flood his bathroom. It's brilliant, everyone wins. So how important is all of this really? Like all of these little problems in our life that are, you know, designed in a pokey-oak way so we can't experience the error. You know, is it really that annoying if we did experience the errors? I think it would be. And let's talk about doors for a second. Because I think for an example of how bloody annoying it is not to have pokey-oak devices, you need look no further than doors. I think doors and door design in general is a blight on humanity that needs to be stopped. But it's something we can all relate to, like this. So how many times have people experienced this, where you come up to a door, you grab it, you pull on it, and you end up just standing there like a moron tugging at the door and it won't open. I know that this is basically a daily occurrence for me. Or even worse, when you walk up to a door and slam straight into it because you should have pulled when you tried to push. This is a real problem, and it's all to do with affordances. So if you're not aware of affordances, an affordance is a design characteristic that implies interactivity. So it's designing something in a way that it's immediately obvious by looking at it how I should interact with it. And doors are a really good example of this. So if I have a push door, a good use of design would be to put a plate on the side of the door that I should push. Because there's no handle, nothing for me to grip, I can only push it. It's a pokey-oke device because I can't interact with it any other way than by pushing it, so I can't get it wrong. Pull doors are a little harder, but if you design a handle that's very clearly meant to be gripped and pulled, that interaction is implied, and therefore you don't get that horrible issue of people slamming into your door all the time. I'm going to stop banging on about this in a second, but I do think door design is one of the biggest challenges our society faces. When your door needs an instruction manual, like many do, it's just poor design, and this is something that if you come at it from a pokey-oak mindset, it shouldn't be necessary. As an aside, if you want to learn more about really awesome door design, this is probably the most important book ever written. It's written by a chap called Don Norman, and it's all about just really good product design. Would recommend. So why the hell have I spent 15 minutes ranting onto you about plug sockets and doors? What's the point of all this? Well, like many of you, I'm sure, I work in designing digital products. And I think that there's an awful lot we can learn as experienced designers about how to design good experiences from pokey-oak, from having a pokey-oak mindset. I think at some point, when we made the transition to digital, we regressed a little bit in the world of design thinking. We started to think that it was acceptable to put user errors, well, to put errors onto the user, to make it their problem. When in reality, what we should be thinking about as designers is how to plan interactions so that those errors can't happen in the first place. So, like Toyota's production lines, we need to think about our interactions in a way that makes failure impossible. So I'm going to go through a few examples of digital interactions that can be pokey-oak. So the first one's a fairly common feature in e-commerce. It's this idea of adding something to your basket, right? So you've got a website selling super awesome shoes. And like many websites that sell shoes, it's necessary for the user to select their shoe size before they can add it to the basket. Now, the size needs to be selected before the user can add some their shoes to the basket, right? If they try and hit the add to basket button without seeing the selected size, it throws an error like this one. Now, this isn't the end of the world, but it is a bit annoying. Just like how, you know, you can't put the bugs off it in the first time, it's not the end of the world, but it is annoying. So what if the user forgets to select the size, or they didn't see the size selection? It's not going to like ruin anyone's day, but it is going to be one of those little things that gradually build up and annoy people until they may eventually leave and go buy their shoes from somewhere else. So how can we redesign this to be a little nicer? Well, instead, we can use affordances, such as more prominent button styles, to draw the user's attention towards the size selection first. What we can also do is disable or deactivate the add to basket button until a size has been picked, right? So instead of saying add to basket, we can first say select a size in that space. When a size has been selected, we can then use animation or styling or whatever other affordances we like to draw the user's attention to that add to basket button. It's splitting it into a two-step process, but it's preventing the possibility of error. Same sort of thing with registration forms. So forms are one of the most common places on the web where you may experience errors. And that's because we're getting a lot of input from the user, so there's a lot that could go wrong. And a lot of it comes down to data validation, right? So when we have a database that takes user data, such as a registration form, we're capturing their date of birth. And for our database to make sense, the date of birth needs to be stored in the same way for all of our users in the same format, right? It just makes sense. So what a lot of websites do is put the onus on the user to enter the date of birth in the format that we need it. So they'll get a tooltip like this one that says, please enter your date of birth in the following format. But what if they decide they want to ignore that and just type in whatever they want? This seems a bit outlandish, but based on the user testing work that GDS do, or a lot of the governmental services, it's very common. What will happen on a lot of sites is that we'll blame the user. You know, we'll make it their problem. We'll say, you didn't do it right, stupid. You need to do it in that format. And it's just a bit rude. So what can we do to rethink this interaction? Well, good first step is to break it into more digestible chunks. So we split the date of birth field into three separate fields, day, month, year. This way there's less ambiguity about how it needs to be entered. That's step one, and it makes it a bit clearer, but it still doesn't solve this problem as to what happens if the user tries to enter in whatever they want. So yeah, they could enter it in exactly how we'd like them to, but they may type in the word August instead. So what do we do with that? Well, rather than giving them an error, because we've now got three separate fields, the validation becomes a little bit easier. Not easy, but easier. And we can look at those three separate fields, look at what's been entered to them, and we can do the hard work on our end to take that input and convert it into the right format that we want to save into our database. So if they enter the word August, we convert that into 08, and we save that. It's a little bit of development elbow grease, but it's taking what was once the user's problem and making it our problem, doing the hard work for them, and that investment will pay off when we have people who are just feeling better about the form they're designing. Doing a little bit of work behind the scenes like this is, you know, hard work, but it does pay off. I think this is called field reflection, this statement. It's very cool. Another example, it's a pretty old one, and I feel like we're kind of gradually phasing this one out, but it's quite an important one because I think it highlights the importance of poke yoke interactions. A lot of e-commerce sites in the past used to have advanced search, a bit like this, where the user would have the option to do an advanced search. They'd be able to fill out whatever they like, so they'd get, you know, a whole bunch of fields. So we're talking about our Super Awesome Shoes website. They can put in, you know, style, color, size, brand. They can be very specific. Click the Find Shoes button, you're too specific, and we don't actually have anything that is yellow, high-top leather Converse for less than 20 quid. This is really annoying for the user, and it's probably going to result in them leaving and going looking somewhere else. What we should be doing instead is having a faceted navigation system, a bit like the one that you'll see on sites like ASOS, where you'll have a bunch of filters that you gradually use to narrow down the selection of products. Now, as every time you select a filter, the remaining sub-filters that you can select may or may not be disabled based on whether or not that will give you zero results. So the idea is that the user can never filter themselves into oblivion. We don't allow them to do that. Again, this is a Poppio interaction because it's not allowing the user to give themselves zero results. Speaking of zero results, this is a bit of a bugbear that I have in usability in general. I do a lot of usability studies, and this is one that I see coming up again and again, and it always amazes me how often it does happen, is zero results found page is not really being planned into the user experience. So quite often your site will have a free text search like this one, and in the event that the user types in something that we just can't give them anything for, what do? You say, no results have been found. That's not very helpful. Instead, we can apply a Poppio mindset to the zero results found page. What can we do to stop this from being a problem, stop it from being an error? eBay have a really good example of spell check, because rather than treating the spelling mistake as an error, what it will do is it will take the user straight through to the correct spelling. You won't even mention anywhere here, there's nothing here that implies something bad happened. It's not treating it as an error, it's saying, we're showing results for trampoline. If you still want to see results for trampoline, you can, but this is probably what you wanted to see. And, you know, it's just positioning it in a much nicer way than saying you made a spelling mistake. Sometimes there is literally nothing that can be shown, but we don't have a product that matches the search criteria, but we can still provide meaningful interactions. So Wayfair have a good example of this, where they'll have the really prominent contact us button, so that you can start a conversation with them offline, maybe they can help you there. Or maybe you can shop by department and find what you're looking for in a slightly different way. When we were designing ListMaker, this was a really important concept because we wanted to build zero results found pages into the content strategy. So the site's all about user-generated content, you're making top 10 lists. If you search for something that doesn't exist, rather than saying to the user, sorry, we got nothing, you actually celebrate it. You say, oh my god, great, you're the first person to have this idea. Why don't you make the content? So planning an error into the user journey and kind of morphing it from being an error to being a, you know, an opportunity almost is really important. Just talking very briefly about styling, because we talked a lot about interactivity and processes, but how things look is also very important. And even a really well-planned experience can fall down if you're not presenting things properly. Talked a lot about affordances already, but very important for your user interface. You should know exactly what something is before you click on it or before you tap it. You can see here, you've got a button at the top that doesn't look at all like a button. There's no way from looking at that that I'd know what it was supposed to do. However, if you gradually apply affordances to it, it becomes immediately obvious how that control will behave when I click on it. So this sort of thing is important for making failure-proof UI. Same goes for mobile interfaces and making sure that you're designing for big, pudgy human fingers that may accidentally tap the wrong thing. Fitts law is a pretty complicated concept, but it kind of equates to size does matter. just design for the medium that you're designing in. This has been just like a sort of really skimming the surface of what Poppio is. I more just wanted to introduce everyone to the concept because I read about this and I thought it was really cool. It's a really important philosophy for us as designers because with careful planning, we can actually prevent errors rather than trying to plan for them. So a little homework assignment for everyone here. The next time you're designing, you know, a website or an app or whatever, and you're running up against a really nasty error state or problem state, and you're not sure what to do, try, you know, just taking a step back, thinking about the bigger process, and think, how can I plan this interaction so that error may not even have to happen in the first place? It can be hard work, but it does pay off. So that's basically me. If you want to learn more about plug sockets, you can read some of my blog stuff at Just UX Design, and List Maker is still really early days, and I'm talking to a room full of designers. So if you guys have any feedback to give me on it at all, I'd really appreciate it. Yeah, that's the end of my rant.
Cool. So, do we have any questions?
Where can we find more information about Tokyo? Where did you start?
I first read about it in a book called Designing the Obvious, A Common Sense Approach to Usability, I think the book is called. I can't remember who wrote it. If anyone here is a real bookworm, you might already know. The cover has a spoon on it. I guess it's a spoon, it's a really well-designed device. But that has a big chapter about Tokyo, but I liberally nicked a bunch of stuff from these slides. So I would definitely recommend that.
Do we have any more questions? Okay, I guess Chris is gonna have one more question.
Well, thanks very much. Very fascinating concept. On the first example, why don't you think that the Tokiyoki or whatever solution? So your first example was about the shoes selection, selecting the right size. Was it me?
No.
to me, the right solution would almost do make the size selector button, the submit button. Is it on purpose that you didn't make it?
Are you just better at your job than I am? I think that's a really good point. I guess the reason a lot of sites don't do it is because it's quite hard, because you might have one product page template, right? But between different products, you might have one shoe that is available in three different sizes and one that's available in 30 different sizes. Drop downs are quite easy because you can put three or 30 things in a drop down. Button styles, it's quite hard to plan for what happens if there's 3 or what happens if there's 30. But I do feel like if you put enough work into it, you could make that work without the horrible drop down button error. But your point is absolutely spot on.
And maybe just a second one. So if I take the concept of Pokiyoki, I guess what iPhone is doing with this single physical button at the bottom of the screen, it's kind of a Pokiyoki strategy where you've got only one thing to do if you want to leave what you're currently doing, the app you're currently visiting, it's clicking on it. Why do you think, and I'm a big fan of Android, why do you think Android has kept the same principle since they launched their first mobile in 2007, I think?
Yeah.
Like three buttons, a back button, a switch app button, and a home button. And why do they keep doing these? Because I think there's a fine balance between Pokiyoki, like very simple interactions, and offering a bit more to the users.
I mean, I think something can be complicated yet still be happy egg designed. So, I don't know. I mean, I guess some of it could be a legacy thing with Android. Like, you know, they've always been designing their apps that way. You have to continue to support the old apps. Personally, I think I prefer the iOS method, just because personally, when I've designed Android apps, I've always run up against this thing of like, okay, what does the menu button do, and how do we make that behavior consistent with other apps? And you can't, because they're all inconsistent, and suddenly it's all a bit messy. Why they do that? I don't know. I guess it's just, you know, their design attitude.
We have one last question. Okay, so Chris will be here afterwards if you want to have it chat with him. I really like your talk, Chris. I think that it's super important to start having this kind of design thinking, because by the end of the day, no one goes to websites to try to figure out how to work the website or the application. They're trying to just get something done and leave. So, yeah, don't ruin people's days, guys. Cool. So, please thank everybody, Chris, for the talk.